Why Thailand? Well, it's got a lot going for it as a fishing destination. For instance, it's hot all year between 85 and 95 degrees, which means the water temperature averages between 80 and 90 degrees. And that's most important because it means that all the fish stocked into the lakes and rivers grow very fast at an alarming rate, and they've all got tremendous stamina. We've got something like 6 species that grow to over 100 pounds, and 4 of those grow to over 200 to 300 pounds. So the fishing there is absolutely spectacular. Apart from that, I love Thai food. So does my wife, Jo. The little bit of arthritis that we both suffer will perhaps go, we hope. The cost of living is less. There's no central heating oil and gas, etc. And it's a challenge that we're really looking forward to. No, not really. I've lived 70 years of my life in the UK, done a lot of things. I've lived abroad as well in Barbados. I spent a few years in the Merchant Navy on a ship. And I've lived here at Lake House, with these lovely grounds, for 31 years. I've done everything I've wanted to do, run fisheries, planted trees, raised the kids. And it's a new challenge, a very new challenge for us. And it's something I'm very much looking forward to. The changes have been astronomical. In my last two books, One Man's Passion for Carp, where I did a biography of my good friend Norman Simmons, who owns Homersfield Lake, but owned Fisher's Green and Waveney Valley Lakes, and stocked carp into many waters all over southern Britain. And I've just finished this book, my Where to Fish book in Norfolk and Suffolk, the 8th time I've written it in 40 years. The changes, I mean, I could sit here for an hour telling you how it's changed. Basically, it's gone from roach fishing to carp fishing. When I was a kid living in North London, there was one lake, 40 Hill Lake, where I caught a lot of wild carp before my paper round, funnily enough, or after my paper round. And that was the only place I could catch carp. Most of the lakes now that hold carp, even 40 and 50 pounders, weren't even dug when I was a kid. It's only our fascination with motorways, the M4, the M1, and everywhere else in Britain that's given us all the lakes that now stock with carp. At the same time, of course, all the clear flowing upper reaches of the rivers in Norfolk especially have all been denuded of roach and dace by cormorants. And so, whilst John Wilson would soon be trotting down a river with his centre pin, holding back and catching a big roach in the winter, I can't do that anymore because there's very few places to do it except the tidal reaches, which I do every now and again. But basically, it's enjoying a wealth of carp fishing. I mean, in this book, when I did the records list at the end, I could have filled it with 30 and 40 pound carp. More so than I could have filled it with 2 pound roach 30 years ago. So in the 40 years that I've been writing this, I first wrote this in 1973, that's exactly 40 years ago, the change has been astronomical. Well, this for me is the big question. And it's a little sad in a way that the Environment Agency, having charged anglers 25 million to look after their rivers, have not done so. Years ago when you had a licence, you had a little book of rules with it, and it said that the Environment Agency or Angling Water or the National Rivers Authority or the East Suffolk and Norfolk River Authority, which have all controlled these rivers around here in the last 40 years, the implication was that they had to maintain and protect our inland waterways. They haven't done that. They do loads of surveys, and that's about all they do. And the surveys brought forth the knowledge that we have now got the lowest run of eels ever, ever in our history. And as eels are supposed to be the otter's favourite food, you can understand why the otters haven't got a lot to eat in the rivers, especially as the cormorants have wiped out most of the roach and dace and rudd in the upper reaches of the clear flowing rivers. We're not talking about broadland rivers now, deep rivers that otters find trouble with lots of people around actually getting a living from. We're talking about the clear flowing hundreds and hundreds of miles of the upper reaches of the River Bure, the Yare, all these rivers in Norfolk. And I think it's very sad that they didn't do any feasibility studies before they then helped Natural England to introduce otters. Because it was bad enough with the cormorants taking out all the middle fish, and now the otters are taking out the few big fish that are left. And whilst we do nothing about those otters, nothing's ever going to come through to get big again. 5 years ago, I helped form the Predation Action Group with Tim Paisley and various other guys because I could foresee this was going to be a big problem. And to those of you who are in parts of Britain where you've never seen an otter and you haven't got your chub and barbel being eaten on a daily basis, then fine, you've got no reason to worry at the moment. But when you do, you'll understand that the otter is not a little cuddly, furry tarka. It's the world's largest predatory rat that not only eats fish, it eats any other little mammal, snakes, toads, newts, frogs, and it eats lots of ground nesting birds. I live here in peaceful surroundings where it looks as though it's a wonderful wildlife haven. It's not anymore because the otters eat all the ducks on nests. I haven't seen a duck here, a mallard, swimming along with 10 little bumblebees behind her for 3 years. Now those otters take the ducklings off the nest, they take them off the water, or they eat the eggs before they even hatch, and they eat the mum on the nest as well. You see, and I'm sorry to be long with this, we've got to go back 50, 60 years, 70 years to when otters were last, not common, but seen around in Britain. Prior to that, like foxes, they were hunted, and you can understand why our forefathers hunted otters, because they were a pain in the neck. They used to eat all these other creatures and eat the fish that people used to eat, because in those days, people used to eat freshwater fish. So the otters had to be controlled. Then there was that big time when we didn't have any otters. Right up until the late 1990s, when the Environment Agency, with Natural England, in their infinite wisdom, decided to reintroduce them. And of course, since then, they've multiplied. And there's nothing you can do about it. Nobody's hunting them. And they're just going to run riot. And they're eating all the big fish that we want to catch. They're going on to people's garden ponds. They're going into every carp fishery. And in the Predation Action Group, we're trying to bring back the farmer's defence, which is that if your dog worries a farmer's sheep or the ewes at lambing time, he's allowed to shoot it. Well, I can stock my lake, as I have, with lots of big expensive carp, and you know, a £20 carp costs you £500. An otter can kill all them and leave them for a fox to drag off. Well, I've got nothing to, I can't do anything about it. Well, that's wrong. We need to be able to, fisheries need to be able to control otters or anything else that eats their stock, just like the farmer. Okay, there are actually two UK catches that spring to mind that I could never duplicate. One is a catch of 9 double-figure bream that I caught slider flow fishing from a boat, which is, I've got that on video. That was quite a unique session, and that was years before people started getting double-figure bream on carp gear. I set out specifically to catch these huge bream, which were nearly 14 pounds on float tackle. That was wonderful because each of those fought like a double figure carp. And I guess perch fishing on the ewes, really. I think I had 3 sessions when I caught no less than 4 perch per session over 4 pounds. I think the first one was the most important one because it had perch to, I think, 4 pound 8. And catching so many huge perch. Dick Walker, my hero of the 50s, used to write that there's no bigger fish than a perch. And until you've had a 4-pound perch, you don't know what he means. But when you hold, you behold in your hands a 4-pound perch, you think somebody must have made it, it's too big. And catching those 4-pound perch all in one session, four of them, along with those 9 double-figure bream, I think would remain my most memorable catches. Well, in recent years, I haven't really done as much fishing as I would like to have done. I've done some abroad fishing and been formulating whether we're going to live abroad and this, that and the other. But locally, my good friends, Terry Housego and Nick Beardmore, further afield, Martin Bowler, who he and I still fish together when we can. It's a difficult one, really, because a lot of my fishing over the years has always been on my own, because I've got up early in the morning and gone out and photographed myself first with a bulb release and then with automatic bits and gizmos on digital cameras. And I don't really have, these days, a regular fishing buddy. For 10 years, when I used to fish the Broads for big pike, the late Doug Allen I used to fish with quite regularly, and for big bream, the late Charlie Clay. Sadly, several of my friends are all late friends. And I guess as you get older, that's what you have to accept. There's lots of different lakes and rivers that I will miss fishing. I will miss fishing the Upper Wensum for big roach, if it had any big roach left in it. And I shall certainly, now I've with Martin Bowler a few weeks ago, enjoy the River Wye for its barbel, I will certainly miss fishing that. I thought to myself when we were there, goodness me, this is the last trip I'm going to make here, and because there's mile upon mile upon mile of it, and I'd love to sample more of it. But there's not a lot I'm really going to miss, because I've had a wonderful life of fishing all over the British Isles, cool sea and game, and fishing abroad. I fish in over 60 countries and I've got some wonderful memories, so I don't really think I'm going to miss fishing anywhere in particular. Well, I think, and again it relates to there being big roach in the river, the most important style I will miss is float fishing with a centre pin reel. It's nice to see my old mate Dave Harrell is enjoying such a wonderful run on the rivers, because he's such an experienced angler with barbel and chub and roach, etc. But around here in Norfolk and Suffolk, I came back to Norfolk and Suffolk in the 70s because of the wonderful roach fishing, and sadly, for various reasons, I can't go out there and long trot for roach. But I have moved to other counties in recent years. I've gone down to the River Test and the River Dever and the Ouse, and enjoyed some long trotting. Long trotting, to me, is the most skillful of all techniques, because you're working a centre pin reel, you're looking, you can't keep looking at the reel, you're looking at the float as it's going downstream. You're lifting it up, lifting it over weed beds, over gravel bars, and when you strike, you don't know what that fish is going to be, because it could be 30, 60 yards away from you. And if it's a small hook, you've got to be very careful as you play it upstream again. Just when you're going to net it, up pops a 20-pound pike and goes off with it, and you think, I don't believe it. Wonderful fun. If I had one technique, it would be long trotting. No, I like to think I haven't got a single regret, because I don't wish to grow old as an angry old man moaning that the Wensum hasn't got any roach in it anymore and things like that. I'm going to Thailand, we're going to have a fishery there, and I'm going to follow my fishery instincts with all these weird and wonderful, huge, exciting, very colourful species. So I'm going on to a new thing. I've got no regrets for the fishing in England, in Britain rather, because I think it will evolve on its own. Again, I've got to relate to the book, because it's ridiculous in that now there's over 500 entries in here on where you can fish in still waters in Norfolk and so on. Not forget the broads, lakes, meres, ponds, gravel pits. There's an enormous amount of fishing in Norfolk and Suffolk now, even if you forget the broads. And it didn't exist 40 years ago when I first started writing about. Everybody was coming in for trotting rods and centre pin reels and hoping to catch a 2-pound roach. Now, if you go around most tackle shops, 90% of it is packets on the wall with carp fishing gear and rigs and baits and bivvies and bolt rigs and buzzers and boilies and everything else. It's a carp fishing world we now live in, and everybody's embraced that, and kids really coming through in fishing now don't think of catching goggle-eyed perch and roach or dace trotting. They think of catching a 10-pound carp. And who am I to say that's wrong? Very much so. I loved fishing in Britain. I think I've had probably the best time that any angler could possibly have in Britain in the last 40 years. I've seen the swing from carp to roach. I've run my own fishery here at Lake House for 30 years. I've planted lots of trees. I've planted lots of colourful lilies. I've looked out every day on this beautiful view that really is unique. And I've caught lots of fish along the way. So I haven't really got a single regret. It's just that Joe and I, we're just moving on to another stage of our life, just a new venture. Well, if you need to specialise, as I've done over the years, and I've had a wonderful career in Britain, get yourself out there sea fishing. Catch a few bass from the beach. Go up to Scotland and catch a big skate along Oban. Go to the Wye and catch a bag of barbel. Don't just put up with your own environment, because it might not have all you contain. And I think the angler tomorrow, I mean, I've run trips to various countries all over the world in the last 20 years for a tour company. And it's been a fabulous time for me, because I've caught huge fish all over the world. But you can do that in your own country. We've all got good cars now. It doesn't take too long to get anywhere. 2 or 3 hours you can be, instead of sitting on your canal where you're only going to catch roach and perch, broaden your horizon. Go and fish new places. Just recently I went over to the River Wye to fish with my good mate Martin Bowell, and we had a whole load of barbel, which I wish we had here in Norfolk, but we don't. So I went over there to enjoy it at 70 years of age. You can do it too. No, I don't think so. Obviously, we're going to come back for special occasions every now and again. But no, we've spent a lot of money having a bungalow built out there next to a beautiful lake that I've had reshaped. It's a jungle setting, and we've got lots to do. I'm not saying in later life, if one of us or both of us become decrepit and we can't handle it out there, then we won't be back. But who knows? You know, people say, are you going for good? And I say, what's for good? I don't know. I'm going with great intentions and a lot of hope, and really looking forward to it. That is another very big, difficult question. I would love to get hold of some kids and show them the delight of putting a float down running water. I would love to have kids spend more time looking through Polaroid glasses and climbing trees than they do sat in a bivvy. But that's just my own thing, really. Each generation has its own sets of guidelines and rules by which you live. And it's probably unfair like for an old codger like me to say what I want to see, because the youth of tomorrow is already enveloped in the way it fishes and its desires and its hopes and its dreams. And you can only do good and you can only be well known and good at what you do in your own generation. And so I find that a difficult question to quantify. Well, I think I'd like to be remembered for the broadcasting I've done. I've made 160 half-hour television programmes in 25 years. I've contributed to over 90 books. Over 40 of them have been my own books. The others, chapters and prologues and bits and photos and in other people's books. And just recently, I think if there's a legacy that I'd like to bring on, and it's ironic really because I'm a 70-year-old fuddy-duddy, and to have this technology on this new book of mine, which is developed by Rico, where you click on the front page of the book and you actually watch on your iPhone or tablet a half an hour video, I don't know what more modern and better legacy I could possibly leave than that.